Do I think we started too late? Yes, of course. This is COP26. It's actually 27 years. That's more than a quarter of a century. That's completely not okay.
Hello and welcome to G0 World. I'm Ian Bremmer, and today we look at the global response to climate change. Will anything substantive actually come out of the United Nations Climate Change Conference in Glasgow, or will we see more of the same? Big commitments, but little action from our world leaders. I speak to Inger Andersen. She's the executive director of the UN's Environment Program, to find out if a G0 world can also become a net zero world. Then, the United Kingdom has already pledged to cut its carbon footprint, but Britain's current gas crisis has nothing to do with climate change. But first, if you've been paying attention to the climate fight, chances are you've heard of COP. Greta's been, Leo's been, Al Gore's been a few times. But what is COP exactly? That acronym stands for Conference of Parties. That's UN speak for a big annual meeting between 196 countries and the EU, all of whom signed on to the Framework Convention on Climate Change back in the early 90s. The first COP summit was held in Berlin in 1995. The first big breakthrough, though, didn't come until the Kyoto Protocol 2 years later. It was an agreement that committed rich industrialized nations to either lower their emissions or pay for carbon-lowering projects in the developing world. And it failed. The US Senate refused to ratify the treaty, and Canada dropped out to avoid a $14 billion fine for not hitting its targets. And poor countries like China and India, they began to grow at such a quick pace that global emissions after Kyoto soared. Further progress on climate policy wasn't made until 2015. The Paris Climate Accords were seen as a groundbreaking deal, and nearly 200 countries agreed to limit global average temperature increases to below 2 degrees Celsius, preferably closer to 1.5, over pre-industrial levels. And for a while, things were going better, at least initially. More than 130 countries have committed or are considering reducing emissions to net zero by 2050, meaning they'll remove as much greenhouse gas as they put into the atmosphere. Even the United States was on board with Paris. But in 2017, then US President Donald Trump withdrew from the Paris deal, leaving scientists to wonder whether it would even be possible to mitigate climate change's worst impacts without one of the world's biggest polluters being involved. And although Joe Biden has brought the United States back on board, many still see the Paris Agreement as nothing more than hot air. See what I did there? Greta Thunberg, one of the world's most vocal climate activists, is skeptical that world leaders will be able to deliver.
Build back better, blah, blah, blah. Green economy, blah, blah, blah. This is all we hear from our so-called leaders. Words. Words that sound great, but so far has led to no action.
She's right to be worried. Experts say with current policies in place, the world is on track for a global warming of closer to 3 degrees centigrade. One irony, of course, is that even hosting one of these UN summits emits 60,000 tons of CO2 into the atmosphere, the same emissions as roughly 7,000 homes in a year. The biggest reason is air travel. Organizers say they will offset the emissions by planting trees, which is nice. As for global cooperation, governments have so far failed to provide COVID vaccines to most of the world's poorest and most vulnerable people. So is there any hope that we're going to do better on climate change? UN Environment Program Executive Director Inger Andersen certainly thinks so, but it's going to take a lot of work and kind of fast. Here's our conversation.
Inger Andersen, thank you so much for joining me today.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting.
Leaders around the world now, not all of them, but a lot of them, are certainly talking as if responding to our environmental emergency is the top priority they have. What's the gap? How are they actually acting? in your view right now?
The G20, the largest 20 economies, are responsible for 78% of all carbon emissions. So if these 20 countries make the requisite shifts, frankly, we are out of the climate crisis, provided we provide fair finance to those where many countries, and as you know, UNEP and my headquarters, I'm on the road right now, but my headquarters is in Nairobi. We have many neighboring countries where you have 20, 30, 40% access to energy. So they need to expand their energy productivity and network, and they need to do it with a non-polluting energy source. So also financing need to be on the table. But so you're asking, what is the gap between fine words and fine deeds? When we add all of this up, as you will have seen in the news, we are heading towards a 2.7 degree temperature increase, Celsius.
Centigrade.
Yeah, yes. Centigrade by the end of the century, 2100. That is a situation we cannot fathom. And so therefore, taking action is needed, and that is what we're pushing for. If we include what is called the conditional elements of these, i.e. where poorer countries saying, okay, yeah, we can do that if we have the technology or if we have the financing that was promised, then it will take us down to, I think it's 2.3 or thereabouts. So still not where we want to be. In the IPCC, which is the International Panel on Climate Change, which we host.
They put out this massive report from the entire world saying, here's where we are right now. Here's
where
we're going.
There are five scenarios. One takes us way out to, 7-8 degrees. So that's, and the most optimistic scenario takes us, yes, past 1.5, hitting 1.7 at around 2070, at which point we bend the curve because we have made this stretch. We've dealt with the three big sectors, transport, energy, and buildings and construction, and we brought down our energy and CO2 emissions. So that's where we need to get to, and that's what the Climate COP 26 will be focused in on.
Can we have capitalism as it exists today? Is it compatible with an optimistic path in how we respond to climate?
Two things. We cannot have capitalism in a collapsed world, first of all. In a world where fires, inundations, floods, droughts, mass movements of people that will cause huge disturbance, that's actually the scenario we need to avoid. And so that's just the first point. That's not, then you would need to have not a free market economy, because it wouldn't work anymore because of the huge disturbance that we would see on food production, on water, on our coastlines, on our infrastructure, and the burden it would have on the public purse in terms of the economy. We just come through COVID and we've seen the burden. What we borrowed to inject into the economy for health and for sustaining the economy.
Now, there's a lot of talk whenever we talk about climate change of 1.5 degrees centigrade. And again, we're not on a pathway to that. We're not close. The most optimistic scenarios don't get us there. But what was the magic behind 1.5? Why was that such a significant place for the world to try to coalesce?
I think because over 30 years, the IPCC, this panel of climate scientists, have told us with ever greater precision what we, most of us, can survive at in terms of the world as we know it. And when we look at 1.5 even, we are beginning to understand, because right now we're 1.2, isn't it? And when we look at 1.5, we're beginning to understand that actually our world will change. The fires we're seeing in California, the fires we saw in Southern Europe, etc. This is not normal. This is a new normal. But also understanding then at which points, because sea level rise will happen, but happens slowly as the ice cap melts, as the sea ice melts, So therefore, understanding at what point do countries as we know them and coastlines as we know them no longer retain the shape and that we know. And therefore, we need to understand that much of the economic might of the world is actually coastal based. We in UNEP, we speak about these three planetary crises: climate, nature loss, and pollution and waste. And we need to get at all three to get to a longer term sustainable planetary existence on planet Earth.
I mean, let me turn to those now. And on biodiversity, we, of course, continue to see talk of this sixth great extinction, the first that is man-made, fully man-made. I mean, one of the most depressing statistics I ever saw was that since I was born, I'll date myself now, back in 1969, about half of all of the species we know on the planet in terms of biomass are no longer with us. That's kind of astonishing to think about. And it obviously is speeding up. Most of the world's media attention has been on what we've been talking about so far, which is carbon emitted into the atmosphere. Very little is about the rest of the species on the planet that don't have a voice, don't get a vote. Talk to me a little bit about your view of that part of your remit.
Well, here's the thing, right? On the climate change issue, it hits us more visually and more real in our economy, our jobs, our, if you're a farmer or whatever you are, a fisherman, you see that things are changing. The fish are no longer where they used to be. They are further north or further south, depending on their climatic conditions. And obviously, with all the floods, fires, etc., droughts, etc. So it's more visual. And I think in the U.S., Katrina, Sandy, some of these big storms were part of many people in the U.S. realizing that this is very real. And of course, now the California and the West Coast fires, I should say. So that's more visible. Whereas biodiversity, first of all, is a technical, difficult word. It's nature, right? It's nature. And nature gives us the food we eat, the water we drink, the air we breathe, and, you know, most of the housing in which we live. So understanding that is harder because one bird or one butterfly or one insect, how does this affect me? But nature is this amazing system where a species nests in one, eats another, migrates to live in a third, etc. So it's very interdependent. Each species woven in to the web of life to the rest. And we take it for granted. It pollinates our crops. You know, the massive hydrological cycle through which water is getting into the skies is because of what happened down in the biomass and how it evaporated back up. These things where we assume that that rain will follow, season will follow season, rains will come when they're supposed to be, and harvest will follow harvest, and the birds and the bees will do their job. This is not something we can assume is there. And when we are interfering with nature, we have altered 76% of the terrestrial surface, the land surface of our planet, and 80-some percent of the sea bottom, if you like, by our activities, by our fishing and by our agriculture. Now, we all need to eat, so don't get me wrong, but we need to make sure that our interaction in agriculture is nature positive. We have fragmented and converted so much land that nature is being squeezed into little corners.
Are you optimistic with the technological fixes that are starting to come into play when we talk about biodiversity, about the genetically modified crops, about, you know, sort of gene mapping and tweaking of some of the species that are on the planet?
Some of these are indeed part of the negotiations under the convention that the U.S. has yet to ratify. But most countries have done so. And technology clearly will form a part of this, but as will just smart farming methods. We can do a lot. The 2 billion hectares of degraded land. Do we need to continue to encroach into tropical forest areas, or should we invest in the degraded lands to make them part of the working landscapes that feeds us? And all of this, and of course how we produce it, we don't need necessarily spatial expansion. We can do vertical expansion and thereby use technology. There are many, many solutions that are abound, and it is entirely possible to feed this world with good diets while still ensuring that nature provides us what we expect it to provide and what we will need for it to provide.
When I was a kid, I also remember the hole in the ozone. And it was very immediate. It was very targeted. It wasn't a huge part of the global economy. And in relatively short order, everybody mobilized, did something about it. We don't talk about it anymore. And part of the challenge with climate is, as we've been discussing today, it's everything. It's interconnected. It's hard to know even where to start.
No, it is hard to know where to start. And but I think we have started. Do I think we started too late? Yes, of course. This is COP26. Is actually 27 years. That's more than a quarter of a century. That's completely not okay. And I'll tell you, in the early COPs, because I was there, I was one of the voices that I don't talk about adaptation. I don't want to talk about adaptation in any way. Why? Because we knew what to be done. So to adapt was to accept that it was going to happen, right? Now I'm on the forefront of saying we need financing for adaptation. So yes, we are too late, but at least it is happening and at least we are moving. And so we are on that climate effort now, and we just have no alternative but success.
Inger Andersen, thank you so much for joining us on G0 World.
It's a pleasure.
As the United Kingdom gears up for the biggest climate conference of the year, Britons have cut back on fossil fuels, but not on purpose. A gas crisis across the pond has led to long lines at the pump, with queues, that's what they call lines over there, lasting for hours. Gas station owners have been attacked, and brawls have even broken out as people attempt to fill their cars. As the Brits would say, petrol is the new loo roll. Gas is the new toilet paper. I'm getting good at this. And panic buying has quickly become everyone's favorite COVID pastime. The situation has gotten so bad that the British military has even been called in to help. So what gives? Well, this situation wasn't caused by low supply, but rather a shortage of lorry drivers, trucks in the parlance. Unfortunately, for Prime Minister Boris Johnson, a post-Brexit Britain means that the freedom of movement once afforded to EU workers has ended. And many have packed up and left the UK for work back home. In fact, the country has lost nearly 200,000 EU nationals in a mass exodus last year, caused both by the pandemic and the country's bitter separation from the European Union. The nation is now suffering its biggest economic dip in three centuries. Industry leaders have been sounding the alarm for months and say the United Kingdom is currently facing a shortage of at least 90,000 truck drivers. The British government has responded by extending 5,000 temporary work visas to foreign truck drivers and encouraging the shipping industry to offer more competitive pay and better working conditions to lure more British drivers behind the wheel. And although gas tanks are filling up again, Boris faces more than just petrol panic this winter. Labor shortages have carried into other sectors too, with British consumers experiencing empty shelves in many shops. This combined with inflation, the end of a furlough program, and a tax hike on the NHS are all creating a cost of living squeeze, making things politically difficult for the Prime Minister's Tory government. And the worst news of all, many Brits will be without Christmas turkeys this year. Poultry farmers blame Brexit and a lack of staffing for a big shortage of holiday birds. That's our show this week. Come back next week, and if you like what you see or you want someone that can help you translate language between English and American, this is the place for you. Take a minute to sign up for G0's excellent morning newsletter. It's called Signal.